I suppose it's fair to say, in my sister's account, I have no career risk. She isn't going to fire me.
Ever since legendary investor Jeremy Grantham told WealthTrack how he kept his sister's money safe during the financial crisis, I have wondered, what about all the other women, many of them divorced, widowed, or lifelong singles, who don't have Jeremy Grantham to call upon? Well, we've started a new feature on WealthTrack's website called WealthTrack Women. On a regular basis, investment pros who specialize in advising female clients will answer questions vital to the financial health of women. Look for it on WealthTrack.com. This week on WealthTrack, Americans are as generous as ever, but how they give is changing. The heads of two leading philanthropies, Lincoln Center's Jed Bernstein and the YMCA's Jack Lund, discuss what donors want and how their organizations are adapting. Next on Consuelo Mack, WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Luma Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Americans are known for their generosity. From the earliest days of the Republic, charitable giving was an integral part of American culture. The French political philosopher Alexis de Tocqueville wrote about this national characteristic in his classic book, Democracy in America. Americans group together to hold fetes, found seminaries, build inns, construct churches, distribute books, dispatch missionaries to the Antipodes. They establish hospitals, prisons, schools by the same method. Finally, if they wish to highlight a truth or develop an opinion by the encouragement of a great example, they form an association. Well, that impulse to join together and contribute to the well-being of society is alive and well today. Americans gave $335 billion to charity in 2013, close to an all-time high. 72% of that, or $241 billion, came from individuals. 95.4% of U.S. households give to charity. The average annual contribution is nearly $3,000. And as in the past, the majority of charitable dollars went to religion, followed by education and human services. In 2013, the biggest increase in giving was in education, which saw donations jump 9%. This week's WealthTrack guests are on the front lines of the American commitment to give and serve their communities. Each runs a leading philanthropic organization based in New York City and are adapting to the needs of their large and diverse communities, as well as the changing interests and demands of donors. Jed Bernstein is president of Lincoln Center, a position he assumed in January of 2014 after a career as a Tony Award-winning Broadway producer, head of the Broadway League, and advertising executive. Lincoln Center is the world's largest performing arts center. It presents more than 3,000 events and educational activities a year, spanning all the performing arts from symphony to opera to theater to dance, film, and arts education. Jack Lund has been the CEO and president of the YMCA of Greater New York for more than a decade. It is the country's oldest and largest Y and New York City's largest private youth-serving organization. Lund has spent his entire career at the Y in numerous leadership roles all over the country and internationally. Under his leadership, the YMCA of Greater New York has expanded to serve 520,000 people annually, including 250,000 kids in 24 branches all over the city. The Y has taken a leadership role in after-school programs, fighting childhood obesity, developing teen leaders, and helping reach and guide disconnected youth. I experienced these programs firsthand as a board member under Lund's leadership for 9 years. I began the interview by asking Bernstein and Lund to identify the biggest changes they are seeing in philanthropic giving.
I think the biggest change in philanthropic giving is the interest on the part of donors in in results. It's there's a merging of the giving instinct and the investing instinct. And they really look to nonprofit institutions to be able to justify what are you doing with this money and what happened when you spent it.
And how do you answer that from your perch at Lincoln Center?
I think you answer that by talking about the number of people involved in a program or touched by a program, affected by a program. And most importantly, you answer it by being clear about the objectives at the beginning. Because all programs don't solve all problems. And if you try to promise that with a particular program, you're not going to get the result that you want, and then you're not going to get that funder to come back again.
So, Jack, 40 years with the YMCA in general, the organization, and now the CEO of the YMCA of Greater New York. So what are the biggest changes you've seen in philanthropic giving?
Well, I would say that it's an evolution, and that, you know, it hasn't happened overnight. But I agree with Jed. I think donors are far more discerning than they've ever been, and they want to see results. In our case, they want to see outcomes, human outcomes. They want to make sure that the organization is supported by its own family, by its board of directors. They're looking for transparency, which I think is a very big issue. And I think a number of things related to holding the organization accountable, which we're seeing more of than we've ever seen.
Right. And Jed, at Lincoln Center, it was founded in the 60s. It was funded by the Rockefeller family and the Ford Foundation.
Lincoln Center was built at a time when basically the leading companies and families in New York got together and said, you know, we need to have this new thing called a performing arts center. They didn't exist anywhere in the world.
Yep.
It's a brand new idea to put multiple arts institutions and facilities in one place. And the Rockefellers and the Ford Foundation led that charge. But every corporate leader in New York, financial, manufacturing, et cetera, stepped up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how Lincoln Center got built. It was budgeted at $80 million for the entire thing, wildly overran its budget at $150 million.
16-acre campus.
16-acre campus. But and we just completed a $1.2 billion renovation of that campus, so 10 times as much as it cost to build the thing to begin with.
The leading philanthropic families, are they still kind of the mainstay of the performing arts, for instance, or has that changed, or how has that changed?
I think that when it comes to individual donors,
individual
gifts, major gifts, it's a combination of families that have always stepped up on behalf of whether it's the arts or healthcare or education and, and all the New York institutions. Certainly it's true at Lincoln Center. But any successful nonprofit has got to have a wide base at the pyramid of giving, because you can't possibly depend on one or two people to write the kind of checks that I need or that Jack needs to keep our institutions functioning. That just doesn't happen anymore. Maybe that was something from the early part of the 20th century, but it's not something anymore. So you depend on those great philanthropists, but you also depend on involving and engaging as many people as you can.
You had those initial funders, and it used to be that corporations would also step up and would write a check just to fund all of the performing arts at Lincoln Center. That's changed, right?
Corporate giving is important to organizations like ours, but unfortunately is shrinking. Here's a sort of interesting statistic. Corporate America in 2013 to the arts gave collectively about $770 million. Generous? But compare that to what they spent on marketing and advertising, $175 billion.
Wow.
So many more times in that area than in the philanthropic area. And the arts used to be able to sort of go to the bank, as they say, on corporate support. We can't do that anymore. We need individuals.
In the case of the Y, for instance, there were founding families of the Y. There's the Vanderbilt Y, for instance, the Rockefeller family again. And so, you know, that was over 100 years ago. So your base of donors as well has changed tremendously.
Well, it has.
And even, and especially, in your experience in the last, you know,
just in
four
the last
decades.
10 years.
Right.
It has. And I think we've always had great support from corporate foundations, from the foundation community. And I think we've done a better job over the past, say, decade at engaging some of the city's leading families and individuals.
Lincoln Center Performing Arts. So when I think of Lincoln Center, I think that's where I go to the opera and that's where I go to the ballet. But it's much more than that. I mean, how has the mission changed?
Well, you know, I think when it comes to the mission, and this is one of the things I admire so much about Jack and the Y, is that the missions have stayed amazingly constant. In Lincoln Center's case, great art for all. Access to great art for as many people as possible. That's what Rockefeller and Ford and the rest of the guys who came together to build this believed from the very beginning. What's changed is what is great art. What used to be in the 1960s, what we now consider the classical high arts,
right,
and those are still at Lincoln Center, and they're still a very important part of Lincoln Center, has now been supplemented by music of all genres and dance of all genres and jazz and things that were never
imagined.
So you're
saying reggae and salsa and
reggae and salsa,
of,
and, right. And we do something like 160 free concerts a year, both outdoors in Delacorte in Damrosch Park and also in our atrium space. And it's music and art of all types, and we really are trying to be the performing arts center that belongs to this whole city, no matter what your interests are. And as I said, that's what's so great about the Y, is that they are very much a modern organization,
right,
but the founding principles are the founding principles.
So talk to our audience who might not be, you know, familiar with the Y, as to what the founding principles were.
I would say that our mission hasn't changed fundamentally, to develop people, especially with a focus on youth and spirit, mind, and body.
Right.
Our methodology has changed. And our organization, like many not-for-profits, has really adapted over time to changing demographics, to changing community needs. And I think one of the things that's driven it for us is what our donor public expects from us.
Mm-hmm.
And so now our focus is around youth development, healthy living, and encouraging social responsibility.
And it's open to everyone, and it's open also to all ages as well, because, you know, we've talked about that from cradle to grave, we've joked about, is that the Y serves the greater community.
I would say that beyond the things that the YMCA is traditionally seen as or expected to do, sort of the gym and swim image, there's been a real focus, especially in New York City, on reaching out to kids and communities in need, kids
right.
and communities that are underserved, and we've been able to bring new YMCAs to underserved communities in New York, most recently in the Rockaways and Coney Island, and we've also been able to bring programmatic initiatives to communities that to help close the academic achievement gap for kids that are growing up in poverty, to address the epidemic of youth obesity, which it is,
right.
In New York City, and I think one of our biggest challenges now is launching a project to reconnect disconnected young people who have dropped out of school, who are not working, and have other serious problems. And we've had some good early success with that, but again, we're just getting started.
Right, and go ahead, sorry.
I was going to say, I think the great nonprofits, and Jack and the Y are certainly an example of that, are able to adapt and redefine. So
right.
the mission stays pure, but the redefinition. It's happening in libraries. What libraries are today are completely different than what they were 50 years ago. It happens with performing arts centers, because the way people consume entertainment is completely different than it was 50 years ago. And it happens at the Y's. And this is what makes strong nonprofits as strong as they are, is that they adapt so they can keep delivering on the mission to the circumstances around.
What are the kinds of programs that you're doing at Lincoln Center that would resonate with, you know, with today's donors? I know there's a tremendous amount of interest now in education.
Yes.
There's a tremendous amount of interest in underserved youth. And there's tremendous amount of interest in you know, health initiatives like the Y's doing with fighting obesity and diabetes. What are you doing at Lincoln Center?
Well, I'll give you two quick examples. Mm-hmm. One is that on the arts education front, we believe that arts education is fundamental to child development, not about because you're going to become an artist, but because it's going to help you concentrate better, it's going to help you work collaboratively better, it's going to help you creatively problem solve better. So we are lucky enough to be one of the probably largest arts education funders practitioners in the country. We, in partnership with Hunter College, certify arts teachers for the public schools. We touch probably, upwards of 50 or 60,000 kids a year in terms of our various programs. And we were asked most recently by the Department of Education to put on a boot camp for underprivileged kids who want to attend the arts-oriented high schools in New York, don't have the resources to train and prepare properly for auditions. And we involved all the parts of Lincoln Center campus to put on a sort of summer camp this summer for them to prepare them. And then we're going to follow them through high school and provide support for them, because they're going to need extra support as they pursue, you know, lives as artists, or maybe just learning more about being artists.
You know, I think Lincoln Center is doing some terrific work with underprivileged kids. And, you know, I think they're that's a forgotten group when it comes to the fine arts. And I think Jed's philosophy is that it's an American birthright. Kids deserve to have exposure to the joy and wonder of enjoying and participating in fine arts. And he's bringing it to those neighborhoods.
And how tough is it to measure these things?
Well, you can certainly measure number of kids served. You can certainly measure, in the case of this boot camp program, do more kids get into the schools than they would have if they didn't come to boot
schools.
Camp? Mm-hmm. So you can quantify these things. But that's why I say it's so important to try to outline your objectives at the beginning, because there's no magic pills, there's no secret sauce, there's no, you know, it doesn't happen overnight any more than it does in the outside world of business and of products and services. It's hard work, and it's step by step, figuring out how to achieve what you're trying to do, learning from the mistakes, and then regrouping and pushing forward again. That's the only way things are going to get better.
And Jack, one of the things that you said before we went on camera was that among philanthropies themselves, there is now a big change, is that there's greater collaboration. And you, the YMCA of Greater New York and Lincoln Center, are starting to collaborate, right?
Well, we've had a history of collaboration, okay. But we're finding some new things to do together. I think one of the laments among the not-for-profit community has been the fact that philanthropy haven't been coordinating their work, or perhaps not as much as could be the case. And what we're now beginning to see, and we're seeing it in New York City, is various foundations, funding sources, including some public funding sources, really gathering together and picking a serious social issue and really using all their muscle to go after it. And I think the coalition that's been put together to address the whole issue of disconnected young people in the city, which really is a problem. There are over 300,000 disconnected young people.
And when you're talking about disconnected young people, define
is. They haven't completed school, they're not working, and they have other serious problems. Some of it's drug and alcohol related, or they're couch surfing, they're mm-hmm. homeless, if you will. And so that's one of the things we've taken on, and we've been really delighted to get supported by a number of funding sources that might not have been the case in the past, and that's because they've all picked this as their priority.
Right, and I'll just say another thing, which I've said in the beginning in the introduction to this program, is that I was a member of the YMCA of Greater New York board for 9 years, and so I've learned about some of these programs, and you've partnered with an organization as well that focused on and has a history of success in dealing with disconnected youth. Instead of reinventing the wheel, and that's another thing, again, the kind of innovation that philanthropies can do, and the Y certainly does very well.
That's certainly an expectation in the not-for-profit community, and that is that we collaborate. And of course, we collaborate with everybody, as does Lincoln Center. We collaborate with the Department of Education. We collaborate with New York City to bring WISE to underserved communities. And we found a lot of ways to collaborate with other not-for-profits. In the case of the disconnected youth and our Y Road centers, we knew we were good at some of the front-end services, counseling, drug and alcohol counseling, et cetera, but we weren't strong in the workforce development area. Mm-hmm. And so we found an organization called Opportunities for a Better Tomorrow, best in class, not-for-profit in workforce development, and we've collaborated with them. We opened up a center a year ago in Jamaica with some good success, and we just opened in the South Bronx. The whole idea is to bring comprehensive services to this group of young people all under one roof, as opposed to the difficulty of navigating a very complicated, disconnected system around the city.
Aside from accountability, Jed, which you mentioned at the top, what is it that donors today are looking for in the kinds of programming that they want to support?
Well, they want to look for money spent on outcomes, not on administration. I think that's probably been a trend for a long time. I think they respect critical mass. A lot of donors feel that if I'm going to put my money, whatever size donation I'm going to make, I want it to make a difference. Mm-hmm. In other words, to gear up for a program, even if it costs in absolute terms relatively less, but to gear up for a program that only touches, 100 kids, how is that ever going to really improve things? It'll make things good for those 100 kids, but how do you scale it? And what is the scalability? So I think that's where the collaboration aspect comes in, that if by combining forces, you can, 1 + 1 can equal 3 or 4 or 5, that really appeals to people.
What do millennials want, Jack? Or is that a factor for the YMCA?
Well, it is, and we're optimistic because mm-hmm. They're a very socially conscious group, and I think what they're looking for is they're looking for results, they're looking for accountability, but mostly they're looking for involvement.
And talk about what does it mean. So it's no longer just writing a check or giving the or going to the annual benefit.
It's engagement.
Involvement is
it's
engagement.
It's all about engagement. Right. I want to see it. I want to touch it. We're doing a program, an arts education program in all five boroughs working with the borough presidents. We've been raising some money for it, and the donors in that particular case they not only love the outline and the goals of the program, but they want to be there. You know, it's like a 16-week, once a week you go into these community centers, 16-week program. They want to be there. They want to watch. Mm-hmm. They want to see what happens.
They want to commit to 16 weeks.
And that's, from our point of view, that's great. I mean, transparency, Jack mentioned before. That's what it's all about. We're happy for you to come and see how we're getting towards the goal.
You know, one of the things that we're seeing in companies now is they're looking for opportunities for their employees,
right?
Many of whom are millennials, mm-hmm. to get involved. And so some of the companies, they've adopted a Y or adopted one of our programs, or sometimes we provide one-off opportunities to come and help us, you know, paint a gym.
Right.
Or some ongoing tutoring, mentoring, those kinds of opportunities too. But that's one thing donors expect now. It's not, as you said, it's not just writing a check, but it's being involved and engaged with the organization. But I have to say the methodology that's been most effective for us with the millennials has been social media. Mm-hmm. And, I have to say that, it's the Wild West of social media these days, and we're just cutting our teeth, but we're getting better at it, and we're finding that that's a very good way for us to communicate with that group.
Right.
Well, I agree with Jack about social media, absolutely, and we're about to invest $8 or $9 million in the sort of digitization of the Lincoln Center campus and mm-hmm. how we engage, etc. We have a slightly tougher road, though, in terms of millennials, because mm-hmm. The entertainment consumption trends are running against us. Anybody who is a digital native, which is anybody who's 35 years or younger, is consuming most of their entertainment on a screen the size of my hand.
Right.
And the tradition of coming to a big building for a program that has been pre-selected, that starts at a time that we tell you it starts, and we tell you not to socially engage while you're doing it. We yell at you if you leave yourself on. So those trends are against us. So we have to overcome that, and we are going to be doing that in a couple of ways. One way is to actually deliver entertainment in other ways, mm-hmm. and that's part of this digital project.
Right.
Another way is by communicating and sampling. You know, you might like a chamber music concert if you knew what it was about. Now, I could wait and die waiting for you to show up if you've never been to one, and I'm going to charge you $100 for it or whatever it is. But if I can get you to start to sample it and experience and understand it, then maybe you're going to come of your own accord, or maybe I have a way for you to sample it that is less painful. So, so it's a little tougher road because God knows everybody's has a why in their.
Our problems are small by comparison.
One last question for each of you, and that is at the end of every WEALTHTRACK, we ask each of our guests if there's one investment we should all make in our long-term diversified portfolio, and in the world of philanthropy, what is the one investment that we all should make? Not your own organizations, clearly.
Well, I think you should invest in Lincoln Center.
You should invest in the Y. I think you should invest. My answer, by all means, support the Y. But my answer also is. Invest in your own community in arts education, because it's not just about the school play. It's not just about the kid who wants to learn how to play the violin. It's really about giving kids tools for living better and more fulfilled lives.
Absolutely.
And Jack?
And for me, it's invest in a kid, and especially kids that are growing up in poverty. And do your homework. Pick an organization that's doing great work with young people. And get behind them and stay behind them.
And the reason, again, to invest in a kid is?
Somebody's got to do it.
Thank you so much, Jack Lund, CEO of the YMCA of Greater New York. Always a treat to have you here. And Jed Bernstein, so delighted to have you here from Lincoln Center. Thanks for joining us. At the close of every WEALTHTRACK, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point follows up on Jack Lund's recommendation to invest in a kid. There are several organizations with a long history of success in giving kids great experiences with lasting, positive, and sometimes life-altering results. I was lucky enough to get involved with the YMCA of Greater New York, which has a 150-plus year history of helping children in neighborhoods all over the city in spirit, mind, and body. But the Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts, Boys and Girls Clubs, and many others do a great job in communities all over the country as well. Children are our future, and they need us more than ever. Have fun and invest in a kid.
I hope you can join us next week. I will have a rare interview with a legendary great investor. Jean-Marie Evillard, the former portfolio manager of the First Eagle Global Fund, will give us his personal perspective on today's turbulent markets.
In the meantime, to watch this program again, go to our website, WealthTrack.com. Plus, if you want to find out what personally motivated Jed Bernstein to get involved in Lincoln Center and Jack Lund to make the Y his life's work, click on our extra feature. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Luma Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation.